Hello everyone, today we have a special lecture slide. I'm going to upload this, let's say PDF on the Moodle afterwards. But if you, actually it's not that long, it's quite short. So if you want, you can copy to your book or whatever. Everyone, this is a new slide because I want to prepare you guys for the 312. The macroeconomic course for the second year, which is more difficult, very, very difficult, in fact. So this will be just some introductory concept so that you can, let's say, know some of the concept in advance and that you will not be surprised when you study the 312 class. Everyone, before we talk about the new concept, let me summarize the whole idea of the neoclassical economics that we studied in the last lecture. Everyone, the first conclusion, let's say the key conclusion of the neoclassical economics is that market is perfect and self-correcting. In this diagram here, I'm going to suppose that we start at this point one, okay? We start at this point one. And let's say that we have a coronavirus, and you see that when you have a coronavirus, people have to stay at home, your demand for, right? No one is going to buy anything your demand for. Everyone, by the way, coronavirus in reality will affect this short run AS as well, but now I'm going to assume that only AD is affected, okay? So in this case, it will be a demand shock, and this is unrealistic, okay? This is unrealistic assumption, but I'm going to say that, I mean, if you don't like coronavirus, you can just say that people suddenly lose confidence. It seems that we will go into the recession soon, people lose confidence and your demand for something like that is acceptable. So in this case, we are going to move from point one to point two here. At point two, everyone, we call this short run equilibrium. Let's go back to here a little bit here. So we say that everyone, in short run, the weight is rigid due to the labor contract, right? You remember I mentioned to you last class, when we start at the full employment, the wage and the price are consistent. The wage are enough to cover the cost of living. So everyone is happy. So we are all in the full employment equilibrium, the long run equilibrium at the full employment. Okay, the weight is high enough. But suddenly when we have a demand shock and now we move to point two, short run equilibrium, remember that the neoclassical believe that the wage is sticky in short run. So right now your price level fall, but your weight still remain at the previous level. So the wage is still expensive, but the price is cheaper, you see. So right now the firm is making loss, right? The firm is making loss. So because the cost that they have to pay for worker is high, but the price that they sell their product is lower. In that case, the firm will have to lower the production. So right now we produce here, right? We have a deflationary gap. We have a higher unemployment. We produce less, we have higher unemployment. But everyone, we continue and say that in long run, price and wage are flexible. What do we mean by this? It means that they are going to adjust in all market. Everyone, this all market mean the goods market and the labor market as well. Okay, so the price and wage are going to adjust in all market. And to clear all market, actually, to clear all market. So right now we have, you could say that we have unemployment, right? We have unemployment here because the wage is too high. The wage is too high. So what happened is that when price is lower, the wage, the firm will say that, oh, I can't go on like this. You are getting too much wage from me. I'm going to lower the wage. And then because of the way, I mean, when they change contract, when they sign new contract, they can get a lower wage, right? And the firm, are happy right now, right? Because they get lower wage. So they are going to supply more. They will this will shift the short run AS to the right. And everyone, we are going to be at this point three, right? We are going to return to our long run equilibrium at P3. And of course, everyone note that at P3, your wage will adjust and then will be consistent at this price level. So here at this three, you don't have unemployment. You don't have unemployment. The good and service are also in equilibrium, demand equal supply. No unemployment. So you can see that this is the idea of the neoclassical idea. Wage and price adjust or market in our market and full employment is reached in the long run. Everyone, the key conclusion is that the government don't need to intervene. We will eventually reach the full employment. This is consistent to what Adam Smith said. To what Adam Smith said. Adam Smith said that we have invisible hand, right? Invisible hand. Market force will do everything. We will be fine. No, that government don't. You don't need to do anything, right? Government don't need to do anything, and that's the case of the neoclassical. Everyone. However, this idea that the government does not need to intervene anything fail during the Great Depression. During the Great Depression, the market does not clear. Maybe I should write this down. So this is a very short note. So Great Depression. Let's say longer unemployment. Economy is in recession for a long time. So why? And also, so why do we have this? Everyone, by the way, let me say something first. This, the one that we study, this idea here is actually is more recent. This model is newer than the Keynesian model that I'm going to teach you, because this model kind of take into account of what Keynesian said already. But anyway, when I was talking about the idea of the classical economic idea of Adam Smith, is that Adam Smith said government don't need to intervene, market is perfect, everything will clear in the full employment. So which is not true in the Great Depression. We have a longer period of unemployment. Economy was stuck in recession for a very long time. The market did not clear. So what happened is that Mr. Keynes come in, everyone. Mr. Keynes become popular after the Great Depression. Mr. Keynes said that, market is not perfect. It's not self-correcting. And the reason is because we have price and wage rigidities. Because price and wage are not flexible. This word rigidity means it's not flexible. Everyone, in Mr. Keynes' opinion, Mr. Keynes said that price and wage are downward inflexible. Downward inflexible means that it will not adjust downward. You see here in this model, in this diagram here, you see that the wage and the price kind of fall, right? In order to reach the equilibrium, in order for the labor market to clear. But Mr. Keynes said that you don't observe the downward adjustment of price and wage, which is, I think, in reality, this is true. In my whole life, my own life, okay, in my whole life, I haven't seen the case where the employer, let's say, get the wage reduced, okay, except for the punishment, okay, except for the punishment. In my whole life, I never seen the case where, the worker got their get lower wage in recession. I mean, they just get fired. Like in during this time when you have coronavirus, they just get laid off. But rarely they get lower the wage, except we have a, let's say, special agreement with the employer. That's a kind of special case. Everyone, this is the key idea of Keynes. We say that in short run, we don't have the wage flexibility. And more importantly, this is the quote by Mr. Keynes himself. He said that in the long run, we are all dead. In other words, everyone, Mr. Keynes said that we don't have time, okay? We don't have time to wait for the economy to solve itself, to return to the full employment. We don't have time for that. We are all dead in the long run. So Mr. Keynes will only focus on a kind of short run. And the key thing is that, you see, in this case of the neoclassical, everyone, at this point, we have a recessionary gap, right? We have high unemployment. You see, we have high unemployment. So what happened is that the wage fall. Remember that this is this here in this case, price fall, right? So the wage also fall. So when wage fall, firm hire more labor, right? When wage fall, firm hire more labor. So we produce more and we return here. However, Mr. Keynes say that, oh, the wage don't fall, right? The wage and price will not fall. So we will kind of stuck in this recessionary gap for a long time. You will see what he mean after this slide. Okay, so that's the idea. He said that due to the price and wage rigidity, economy may stuck in short run or in deflationary gap for a long time. So you will not reach the full employment. So let's see what does he mean by this. This is what I teach you before, right? This is the idea of Keynesian economy. From this from this summary of Mr. Keynes' idea, we have we derive this kind of aggregate supply curve. We don't have long run, you see, because we say that people are dead in the long run. We only have one, you could call it short run Keynesian curve. So first of all, you see that during this period, this is where you could notice that we have a downward inflexibility. Okay, in short run, price and wage are downward inflexibility. You can see that it does not, your price kind of constant during this phase here. Everyone, let me go through section 1, 2, 3 first. Remember that your full employment will be here, okay? Your full employment, this is where your U equal to your UN. On the other hand, at this point, we have a maximum unemployment. Your unemployment is zero. And this is the explanation of section 1, 2, 3. I'm not going to go into much detail about this one because we don't use this much anymore. Actually, we study in, I mean, most students across the world do study this, but again, the neoclassical is kind of more popular and more, yeah, it's debatable. Anyway, in the section one here, we have a spare capacity. I told you that we have unused resource, everyone. We have unused resource. So what you can do here is that, because we have a lot of unused resource, firm can increase output, you see? Firm can increase output without raising price, okay? They can increase output without raising price. They just need to bring out of the unused resource. to produce more. So they just bring out their unused resource and produce more. They don't need to buy anything. They don't need to buy anything. But in section two here, you see this is section two. Section two, you don't have spare capacity. You run out of spare capacity. You don't have any more machine. So if you want to produce more, everyone, if you want to produce more, you have to raise the price. The reason is simple. We have to buy more input. We have to buy more machine. We have to hire more labor. And when the price increase, to produce more, you have to raise your price to cover the cost. And now at the last section, section three, this is when all of resource are used. So this is when, as I told you earlier, we don't have any more leftover resources. Everyone is working at this section three. And now you can see the idea, everyone. Let's suppose that, look at this last conclusion here. The government may need to intervene. Demand side policy may be required for economy to reach full employment. What do we mean by that? It's like this one. So suppose that you kind of stuck here at this output. Let's say that we stuck at this Y1. You can move to Y2 only when you have the aggregate demand or the demand side policy to let's say move the economy to correct the recessionary gap. Remember, everyone, this is your full employment. If your Y is here, if your output is here, it means that you have a recessionary gap. So that's why he said that government intervention is necessary. This is why Mr. Kane emphasized a lot on aggregate demand. He said that demand is very, very important to move economy out of the recessionary gap here, okay, in order to move towards the full employment. That's the fifth conclusion, okay. May need to intervene. Now, demand side policy may be required to move to YF. Okay, but again, everyone, if the government intervene more, then you can eventually reach this full employment. That's the idea of Mr. Kane. So, by the way, actually, I think I should mention something that is important, but I kind of forgot once again. Everyone, we can kind of expand the economy. You can kind of, this is what we mean by long run growth, okay? To achieve the long run growth, for example, this is the case of Mr. Kane. His long run growth will look like this. On the left hand side, this is the neoclassical version. You should use, government should use supply side policy. Everyone, I'm sure that you guys know some history of Singapore. Everyone, Singapore doesn't have a lot of resource. They are a very small country. But why Singapore, let's say, grow faster than Thailand? The reason is because Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, not sure if you have, I think he's the Prime Minister of Singapore. Not sure if he's the first. I don't think he's the first Prime Minister, but he is the most. I think he's the best Prime Minister in the world that the world can has ever had. So this guy Lee Kuan Yew, he used a supply side policy, namely education. Everyone, education. You can have many more, there is more than education, okay? It can be something like infrastructure and training, worker training, healthcare and so on. But the key, what Mr. Lee Kuan Yew emphasized when he was the Singapore Prime Minister, he focused on education. And you see, this is the result. You can have a kind of economic growth here, represented by a shift in the long run aggregate supply. So now that will be all for the this slide here. And I'm going to talk about now this concept here you will study next year. This is the first of all, everyone, the topic that you are going to study is the Phillips curve. We are going to use the shorthand PC to stand for Phillips curve. Everyone, Phillips curve is the concept. Actually, it's the observation. It's the observation made by a guy named Phillips. And he observed that we have a inverse relationship or negative relationship between unemployment and inflation. Okay, negative or inverse relationship means that if you have high inflation, you will have low unemployment, or vice versa. If you have high unemployment, you have low inflation. Even the idea behind this relationship is that when your economy grow, of course, think about when your AD aggregate demand shift. Okay, when your aggregate demand shift, look, you see, let's use the classical version. You see that when your aggregate demand shift, that's the opposite case. Sorry. When you have a shift in aggregate demand, it's like your output kind of increase, right? And at the same time, your price also increase as well, you see? Which means that when your AD shift, you have more output, but at the same time, you have price level. Again, everyone, when you have more output, it means that your unemployment fall, remember? So this means that you have a negative relationship here, you see? You have a negative relationship between you and inflation. So the logic is that when you have economic growth, it will lead to inflation. But at the same time, when you have an economic growth, it means that you have more job for people, and that means you have less unemployment. But why we concerned about this Phillips curve? Why? Because the reason is that because of this Phillips curve, policymaker will face a trade-off now, everyone, trade-off. Remember, I'm sure that most of you already forget, we have three macro goals that we study in the very first lecture. Output growth, low unemployment, actually full unemployment, and lastly, low inflation. These are the three macroeconomic goals. We have more than this, okay? But this is the three most important goals. And you see that now we have a trade-off. So if you want to have a high employment, or let's say if you want to have a low unemployment, based on the observation, it's impossible, because if you have low unemployment, it will kind of lead to high inflation. So this means there is a conflict, right? This is the trade-off that I mentioned, trade-off between the two macro goals. So how can we, first of all, let me show you the picture of the Phillips curve. This is the observation. You see that we have a inflation rate here and we have unemployment here. And when you have a low inflation, we have a low inflation, you have a high unemployment. But when you have a high inflation, you will have a low unemployment. But everyone, you see, this Phillips curve here, this particular shape here, downward sloping Phillips curve, breakdown, or you could say it failed. Everyone, Philip Curve failed during the stagflation. Remember the stagflation. In the stagflation, we have high unemployment and high inflation. Very bad, right? No job to do and everything expensive. That's stagflation. And so many economists try to explain Philip Curve. I mean, they kind of dispute. They say that, oh, this is not usable at all time. This is not true at all time. They say that Philip Curve is only usable in the short run. I mean, this curve here is only true in the short run, but not in the long run. Okay, but not in the long run. So we are going to this is the actual picture of the Phillips curve by Mr. Phillips, I think. So he observed this data of the UK, and that's the negative relationship, as I told you. So everyone, this is how we derive the short run Phillips curves. Okay, short run Phillips curve. This is the one that short run Phillips curve is this one. Okay, it's this particular shape, downward sloping Phillips curve. We call this short run Phillips curve. We can derive this short run Phillips curve using the ADAS model that we study. Everyone, imagine that this is your short run aggregate supply, right? Short run aggregate supply. You see that if the government, let's say that boost the economy, if the government increase aggregate demand, you see that your output will increase, right? Your output will increase. When output rise, it means that unemployment will be lower and lower, right? You produce more, you have less unemployment. But everyone, at the same time, you have higher and higher price, you see. When your demand increase, your price rise, but your unemployment fall, okay? So at P3, you see that your unemployment, P3 linked with output level 3 here and linked with the U3, because you have you produce more, but your unemployment is very small here. So this is how you derive the short run Phillips curve, very simple here. And this one, this is how you derive the long run Phillips curve. So again, we use the long run aggregate supply, and we do the same thing. We shift the aggregate demand. We shift the aggregate demand. And everyone, you see that your output does not change, right? Your output is there. Your output is at the Y for employment. Only the price will rise when you increase the demand. So when you derive the long run Phillips curve, you see that your unemployment will always be at your natural rate. Okay, your unemployment will always be at your natural rate. So no matter how price change, even though the price change a lot, your unemployment will always be here. That's the same thing. No matter how price change, output will always be here. Everyone in 312, you are going to study a more difficult version than this one. But again, this is just so that you kind of know the concept in advance. So that's all I hope for. Thank you, everyone.